This is Debt Free in 30, where every week we take 30 minutes and talk to industry experts about debt, money, and personal finance. Here's your host, Doug Hoyes.
For our first show of 2016, we're going to bring back two of my guests from 2015 to help us answer one of the most common questions I get asked, and that's, how do I stop the collection agents from calling? So on today's show, we've got the top 10 tips for dealing with collection agents. I've got lots of great tips from two industry insiders, so I'm going to play you clips from my conversations with them, and then I'll be back in the last segment to give you a quick summary of the top 10 tips for dealing with collection agents. And of course, everything we discuss today, including all of the tips and a full transcript of today's show, is available on our website at hoyes.com. That's H-O-Y-E-S.com. So let's get started with some facts from Blair Demarco-Wettlaufer, who manages a collection agency. Back on show number 20, he told me something that many people don't know, and that's that there is something a collection agent must do before they attempt to collect a debt. Here's what he said.
In Ontario, which is probably most of the people listening to this show, what's required by the Collections Agencies Act of Ontario is a file comes in, it gets put into our database, our contact management system, and a collection letter goes out. That's actually required by law. We have to send a letter and wait 6 days before we start calling.
So in every single case, you have to notify the debtor in writing?
Yes, in Ontario.
In Ontario.
Ontario and BC. Now, obviously, if we get a file that's 2 or 3 years past due, we might get no address at all, or an address where mail's been returned, or an address that isn't forwarded anymore. But we still are required by laws written in 1975 to mail out a letter and wait the 6 days.
Okay, so as a practical point here then, if I'm listening to this show and I've got debt and I get a call from a collection agency, I should have already got a letter, or I can at least ask, well, send me something in writing then.
Actually, that's in the act. If a consumer gets a surprise call from an agency, and obviously Canada Post isn't without its quirks, and they say, I didn't get a letter, they have the right under the Collection Agencies Act to have that letter resent. They can ask for it by mail. If the consumer and the agency are willing to cooperate, they could email it to them or fax it to them. But the important thing is the consumer has a right to know how much his claim is owed, who the creditor is, what the lawful name of the collection agency is, and the name of the agent reaching out to them. Those are key points that have to be made.
Okay. So you get the file and the debt could be, like you say, anywhere from 30 days and up in age. Mm-hmm. The first thing you do is send out a letter.
Right.
And you said you have to wait 6 days?
6 days in Ontario.
So there you go. Tip number one for dealing with a collection agent by law in Ontario, they're required to send you a letter, obviously in writing, stating who they are collecting for, how much is owed, the name of the collection agency, and the name of the collection agent who is contacting them. And after sending the letter, they have to wait 6 days to make sure you've received it, and only then are they allowed to call you. If you don't think you owe the debt, or if you think the collection agent has an incorrect amount, you have every right to ask for something in writing with all of the details. If the collection agent can't produce that letter, they can't call you. That's the law. So what if you truly don't owe the money? What if you get a phone call for a debt that isn't yours? That was my next question to Blair. If I don't owe the money, what should I do?
Well, first of all, you should definitely pick up the phone and talk to the agent and let them know. The problem is a lot of agents aren't educated in the laws, or they're not sophisticated enough to listen because they've been trained to demand the money and throw the excuses to the side. Regardless, you should communicate clearly and effectively that you dispute the debt, why you dispute the debt, and what you want to do. If you can do that verbally, great. You know, it could be an issue of identity theft. Huh? My ID was stolen a year ago. I have a police incident report number. Here you go. Give that. Or I've disputed this debt. I have a copy of a letter I sent to Bob the dentist three months ago. I'll send you a copy. Fine. Ultimately, though, if you send a letter, a registered letter to the agency disputing the debt and requesting no further calls, they're done.
So I can actually stop you from calling me.
Yes.
By sending you a registered letter.
Yes. You can't stop the consequences, but you can stop the calls.
Right. So, and the consequences, obviously, in that case would be if I actually do owe the money, then I guess you're going to place it on my credit report. You could return it back to the original creditor who could decide to take me to court and sue me.
A lot of agencies actually have their own internal paralegals and lawyers where they will initiate the legal action. You know, especially when you're dealing with debts of upwards of $3,000 and more. That's when small claims court becomes viable for the cost. You know, no one is going to sue anyone over a $53 library fine. It's just not going to happen. But if you owe, you know, on your visa $6,000 and you're gainfully employed, yes, the threat of legal action could be real.
And so collection agencies will actually commence lawsuits.
Yes.
It's not your common collection tactic, obviously. It doesn't happen in most cases, I would assume.
It depends on the creditor and the agency. There are some law firms acting as collection agencies, and they sue 30-40% of the accounts that come into their office. Our office will choose a handful of files that we'll take legal action on every year. If the debt's over the two-year mark, it falls outside the statute of limitations in Ontario. If the person isn't gainfully employed, we don't want to take legal action because it's the creditor throwing good money after bad. If the debt is too small, if it's under $3,000, we generally don't encourage it. And if the client doesn't have ironclad documentation, a signed contract, invoices, then we can't put a case together. So there are a lot of things that have to happen realistically for legal action, rather than an emotional agent on the phone saying, I'm going to sue you if you don't pay this.
Right. So what you're saying is, if I'm a debtor, the threat of a lawsuit, yeah, it might be a real threat, but you just gave us a list of a whole bunch of times where it's not going to happen.
Exactly.
And so you got to kind of understand your rights. I think this is some great insider information. Over the years, I've had thousands of people come to my office because they're afraid that a collection agent will take them to court. As Blair Demarco-Wettlaufer just said, at his collection agency, there are only a handful of files he gets every year where they will recommend that the original creditor take legal action. If the debt is small, which at Blair's firm may be around $3,000 or less, it's not worth the time and legal fees to go to court. He also talked about the statute of limitations, and we'll get back to that because that's a key point, but I want to get back to this point about getting sued by a collection agent. Back on show number 35, my guest was Mark Silverthorn, a former collection agency lawyer who wrote a book called The Wolf at the Door, What to Do When Collection Agents Come Calling. And I asked him about dirty tricks used by collection agents. And that's where we talked about collection agents threatening to sue debtors. Here's what he said.
Well, the number one dirty trick would be threatening to sue a consumer in circumstances where the bill collector does not have express permission from the creditor to do so. In Ontario, it is illegal for a collector employed by a collection agency to threaten to sue you if the creditor has not authorized the collection agency to sue you. And typically, creditors don't authorize collection agencies to sue files. If they want to file suit, they'd give it to a lawyer or to a law firm. It would never even get sent to a collection agency in the first place.
So it's highly unlikely that a collection agent will sue me.
That's correct. In my book, The Wolf at the Door, I estimate that collection agencies collectively across Canada, fewer than 1 in 10,000 accounts placed with them for collection.
1 in 10,000 times you're going to get sued. The rest of the time, it's an idle threat, in effect, is what you're saying.
Right. Now, if a creditor does want to sue you, then they'll send it to a lawyer or a law firm, or they'll do it internally. So I don't want your listeners to think that the odds of you being sued are 1 in 10,000. It's when if you get a call from a collection agency or if you get a collection notice from a collection agency, your account is going to be with that agency for a period of time. And while it's there, the odds are relatively remote that you're going to be sued.
So there you have it, from two independent sources, a collection agent and a former collection agency lawyer, both confirming that it is possible for a collection agency to sue you, but it's unlikely. A collection agency has to have permission from the creditor to sue you, and it has to make financial sense, and often it doesn't. But, as both Blair and Mark are saying, that doesn't mean you will never get sued. It simply means that it's unlikely that it will be the collection agency that will sue you. In my experience, collection agencies very rarely sue anyone, but it is quite common for the actual creditor, like the bank or credit card company, to sue you for an unpaid debt, particularly if the debt is more than a few $1,000s, and if they know that you have a job, and therefore it is likely they'll actually be able to collect from you. Blair talked about how to deal with a collection agent if you don't actually owe the debt. Of course, in most cases, if they're calling you, it's because you owe the debt. So then what do? One approach is to confirm with the collection agent that they actually have all of the necessary information. Blair already told us that if the collection agent doesn't have ironclad documentation, such as a signed contract or invoices, they can't put a case together, so they won't sue you. Blair also said they must send you a letter before they start calling. So that's what I asked Mark Silverthorn. How should I deal with a collection agent if I do owe the money? Here's his answer.
Well, if I recall correctly, in most provinces, a collection agency is required to send you a written notice 5 or 6 days before they start calling you. So that it's very possible that you've received a written notice from a collection agency before that they've made a call. Now, certainly, if a person wants to speak to someone at a collection agency, they can. And what they may want to do is ask the collector certain questions. And at any time, the consumer should feel comfortable terminating the call. But I've just made a list of some of the questions that you might want to ask a collector.
Fire away.
Well, what is your name? What is the correct spelling of your last name? What is the correct spelling of your first name? What is the name of your employer? What is your phone number? Is there an email address where I can contact you or your supervisor? What is your fax number? What is the name of the creditor on whose behalf you are calling? What is the account number you are calling about? What is the outstanding balance on the account? What is the date of last payment? Are you able to provide me with any documentation proving that I owe this account? And would your client consider accepting a lump sum payment equal to 25% of the current outstanding balance? Hmm.
So I guess what you're saying is, yeah, you can push back. You don't have to just let them yell at you and scream at you and tell you to put your TV on the front porch, which is not even legal anymore anyways. You can ask questions, you can push back. And that's the starting point as a consumer. Get the full information. Get them to put it in writing for you is what you're saying.
Right. And I mean, if you ask the collector for the spelling of their name, the collectors may, if it's an unprofessional collector, the collector may be intimidated by that because the collector, I mean, the reason why you're asking those questions is because if you want to make a complaint against the collector, you need to know the collector's name.
That's some interesting advice. Mark is saying that you don't have to allow the collection agent to bully you. You are well within your rights to ask questions, and if the collection agent doesn't have all of the facts or is doing something unethical, you may be able to scare them off. But again, the more common situation is that you owe the money. So let's go back to Blair Demarco-Wettlaufer for his suggestions on what to do when you get a call from a collection agent.
Well, there are a couple things you can do. Obviously, if you want to pay it, or you feel you should pay it, or you want to avoid the consequences for non-payment, you should reach back out to the collection agent when you get the letter or you get the answering machine message, and you should be honest. Most agents are motivated to collect the payment in full because they work on a contingency. The company, the collection agency, works on a contingency or commission basis. They only get paid if they collect. And some agents are working in boiler room call centers where they're driven. But you as the consumer, what you should do is make a realistic payment arrangement. You shouldn't promise something that you can't do. You should not promise, if you're reaching for that $100 a month payment, don't offer it. You know, offer 70, offer 50, offer something realistic. From the agent's standpoint, the agents often hear every day, oh, I want to pay that bill, but I can't. You know, my dog got sick or I've just lost my job. There are a couple things you can do to negotiate that will get you traction with the agent. The first is if you want to show the agent that you're serious about taking care of this, you can do what's called a good faith payment in our industry. Let's say you owe $1,000 and you've just lost a job and you're starting a new job in 2 weeks and you want the agency to leave you alone. You can say to the agent, Bob, I want to take care of this. I can't right now. I have no income currently. I'm going to pay you $50 right now to show my intent, and I will talk to you in 3 weeks. If you actually follow through with that $50 payment, it's not a lot, but it shows the agent you're actually serious. Actions speak louder than words. The other option you can do is if you want to make arrangements on a balance, you can offer a series of payment arrangements, either through post-dated checks or pre-authorized payments. Be careful with this, though. Make sure that you get your arrangements by email or you're sending checks that are clearly identified as post-dated and that they're made out to the right party, to the collection agency's trust account. The last thing you can do is let's say you dispute a portion of the debt or a portion of the debt is interest that's accumulated over time or you were unsatisfied with the services, you can offer what's called a settlement, a lump sum settlement, where if you owe $1,000, you're offering to pay $700. Protecting yourself as a consumer in this case is very important. Before you pay one dime, you should get what's called a conditional letter of settlement from the collection agency that says, on condition of Frank paying $700 by December 5th, he is released from any claim and obligation relative to this debt. And that way, if Frank makes the payment, he is resolved from any demand on the remaining balance. In most provinces, if you make a partial payment on the debt, that acknowledges liability for the full balance. So if you don't get that letter first, you know, if the agent says, oh, just pay $700 and we'll make this go away, that doesn't protect the consumer, and the file could be reassigned to another agency a year down the road and interest could accumulate. Always get a settlement letter before you make a settlement amount. There are a number of ways you can negotiate with an agency, but the important thing is to be honest and to only promise what you actually can do.
That's good advice. If you know you owe the money and can afford to make some payments, offer to do what you can do. If you can raise some cash to settle the debt for less than the full amount owing, great, make an offer, but always get the settlement in writing. Earlier, Blair mentioned the Limitations Act, or what
they call on TV the statute of limitations.
For legal action is 2 years in Ontario.
2 years in Ontario. So that means if I've disappeared off the face of the earth for 2 years, legal action hasn't commenced, well, probably isn't going to, it can't now. That would be my defense
right.
in court.
The ship has sailed.
The ship has sailed. So let's say I'm a year and a half into this, and I'm talking to the collection agent, and I do what you said, number one there, make a good faith payment of $50. Well, I've just started the 2 year clock again.
Bingo. The yeah. clock resets.
The clock resets.
Absolutely.
Okay. So if I'm going to make a deal, I go back to what you said then, you better make sure you can honor it.
Yes.
Because if I pay that $50, I've now given the collection agent 2 more years to pursue me, in effect.
Exactly. And for credit reporting, reporting to the credit bureau, it has a 6 year window in mm-hmm. Ontario. That clock resets too with a payment.
Yeah, that's pretty dangerous if you aren't going to be able to continue on with it.
So the important thing is to know how much you owe. What are the consequences? Have the consequences been avoided? I mean, a lot of cases, collection agencies aren't sophisticated. They'll list the file on the credit bureau and then call the consumer. To my mind, that's incredibly dumb. Mm-hmm. It's far better to call the consumer and say, I haven't put this on the bureau yet. My clients asked me to. What would you like to do? And consumers react far better to knowing it hasn't been listed with the bureau yet.
So how do you get paid then?
Collection agencies work 9 out of 10 times in Canada. Collection agencies work on a contingency basis or a commission basis. They get to keep a portion of what is collected. And this is important for consumers to know because there's this misconception from TV and US news that collection agencies buy the debt. That's very common in the US and it's starting to become common in Canada, but the debt would have to be 2, 3, 4 years old for someone to buy it. In most cases, the creditor retains ownership and hires the collection agency to act on their behalf. And they could receive anywhere between 10% to 50% of the amount they're collecting, depending on the age, balance, and type of creditor.
So if I'm a collection agent and I know that I'm going to collect somewhere between 10 and 50% is my commission, my contingency fee.
Yeah.
I much would rather get a lump sum, which was your third option there that you mentioned. So if it's a $5,000 debt, I'd much rather as the collection agent get $2,000 right now or right off the rest, take the money, than I would to get $50 a month for the next 5 years.
A lot of old school agencies work like that. In fact, they'll send out as that initial collection letter, a letter offering a settlement right off the get-go. It's like, you know, Oliver Swift begging on a street corner. You know, please, sir, could you only pay mm-hmm. $700 of the $1,000? I personally believe a lot of consumers end up in collections. They're not bad people. 9 out of 10 consumers ending up in collections are procrastinators. They don't understand their financial rights. They weren't aware of the debt. They've had bad circumstances happen, or they've reacted emotionally to a debt and they've made a bad decision. Most consumers don't have a spare $6,000 in their back pocket. That's why they end up in collections. I personally would rather see a consumer make regular payments for the balance in full, where it doesn't strain the consumer, rather than, you know, pin them up against a wall and ask for a settlement.
That's a lot of great practical advice on how to deal with a collection agent. We've got a lot more to come, but we're going to take a quick break, and then we'll be right back. You're listening to Debt Free in 30.
You're listening to Debt Free in 30. Here's your host, Doug Hoyes.
Welcome back. It's time for a summary of our top 10 tips for dealing with collection agents. First, ask for proof of the debt in writing. Under Ontario law, a collection agency is required to notify a debtor in writing at least 6 days before they start phoning you. Second, if you dispute the debt, talk to the collection agent and provide proof if you don't owe the money. Third, you can send them a registered letter requesting no further phone calls and they are no longer allowed to call you. That doesn't stop further collection action, such as a lawsuit, but it does stop phone calls. Fourth, don't be intimidated when a collection agent says they'll sue you because they almost never sue anyone. However, the original creditor, like a bank or credit card company, is more likely to sue you if the debt is large enough and if they know you're working and they are likely to get a wage garnishment against you. Tip number 5, don't be bullied into making a promise you can't keep. Only offer a payment plan that you can realistically afford. Number 6, before sending money on a lump sum settlement, get a conditional letter of settlement from the collection agency so they can't change the deal later. Tip number 7, remember the Limitations Act. In Ontario, a standard creditor, like a bank or credit card company, has 2 years to commence legal action. After 2 years, it's too late, so don't let a collection agency intimidate you by threatening to sue you for a debt that is more than 2 years in arrears. Tip number 8, remember the Credit Bureau purge policy. In most cases, a debt will automatically be purged and not appear on your credit report after 6 years of inactivity, so there's generally no point in making a payment on a debt that is about to be or has been purged from your credit report. Tip number 9, only pay a collection agency when it is in your best interest to do so. Paying one debt when you have lots of other debts doesn't solve your debt problems. Finally, our most important tip for dealing with collection agencies. If collection agents are calling you because you have too much debt, you need to make a plan to deal with all of your debt, not just the one debt the collection agent is calling you about. That's when a consumer proposal or personal bankruptcy may be the best option to deal with your debts once and for all and give you a fresh start. It's a great feeling not having to worry about collection agency phone calls. That's our show for today. Full show notes are available on our website, including links to everything we discussed today and our top 10 tips. So please go to our website at hoyes.com. That's H-O-Y-E-S.com for more information. Thanks for listening. Until next week, I'm Doug Hoyes. That was Debt Free in 30.
Thanks for listening. That was Debt Free in 30.